I'm New Hanover County Public Information Officer Mark Boyer, and welcome to this edition of the Chairman's Chat. The Chairman of the Board of County Commissioners, Jonathan Barfield Jr., is here every 2 weeks to highlight different issues and events affecting New Hanover County and your understanding of the role of county government. And our special guest today, Mr. Chairman, is Albert Eby, the Executive Director of Wave Transit. And thanks for joining us, Albert.
Thank you for having me, Mark.
The reason we asked you today is the proposal to add, what is it, $7 to the vehicle registration fee to provide bus service to the beaches.
Yes, sir. And again, thank you for having me. I think it's important that Wave Transit get our message out there to the community. But when we first started looking at this several years ago, expanding public transportation service here within the county, one of the things we talked about was service to the beach communities. We went and did a study with UNCW and their Department of Public Policy to see what the community felt about public transportation. One thing that we found in the study was that 87% of the folks surveyed here in the county wanted public transportation service to the area beaches. That started a dialogue with the area beach towns, both at Southern Beaches and Wrightsville Beach, and we have recently found that there's some support from the elected officials at both the Southern Beaches and Wrightsville Beach to start talking about a public transportation service to the beaches. Obviously, it'd have to be paid for, and we worked with the legislature a couple of years ago in 2009 to get legislation passed that would allow the county commissioners to implement a vehicle registration fee to pay for enhanced public transportation services.
So we already have that enabling legislation.
Absolutely, and that came from the General Assembly a couple of years ago. It also included an opportunity for counties to implement a quarter cent sales tax by referendum of the voters throughout all 100 counties in North Carolina.
And we know that we were successful in that referendum.
And that was dealing with just a quarter cent for us as opposed to transportation. But Albert, the $7 vehicle registration fee, it's not just about the beach communities alone, is it?
Absolutely not. It's about public transportation as a whole. And the advantage of public transportation is that it's open to everybody. It's not for a certain segment of society, but it's an opportunity for us to help the environment, to reduce traffic congestion, and to provide better use of our roads here throughout New Hanover County. So the $7 would also pay for long-term operation of not just the beach buses, but buses that we provide here throughout New Hanover County into Northern Brunswick County. It would also allow us the opportunity to set ourselves up financially to be able to afford capital items in the future, like large bus purchases and facility improvements.
What is your vision for KFRA Public Transportation Authority 5, 10, 20 years out? What do you see?
Fortunately, the Cape Fear Public Transportation Authority has been very progressive in what we've done. We've reached out and done some things that most public transportation authorities don't do. We do things like we're working on a plan to provide Greyhound service out of our new Fordham station. We provided an indoor bus station in Fordham station where we hope to attract passengers to provide a better atmosphere for folks that want to use public transportation. And so we certainly see that an expanding of those offerings in the human service department, the transportation area, working with our local DSS to make sure that Medicaid transportation is offered by transportation professionals instead of social service professionals. So I would see a growing and kind of a way for Wave Transit to come into our own and to provide transportation through the community without the restrictions of local politics at the city level and the county level.
So KFRA Public Transportation, what we call Wave Transit, has been around now for a couple of years. It resulted from a merger, basically, or consolidation of the county's van service and the city's existing bus service. How's it all been working out?
Like you said, we were created by joint resolution of the Wilmington City Council and the New Hanover County Commissioners in 2004. So we're in our seventh year, and certainly it's been a challenge. Most public transportation is financed through reimbursements from the federal government and the state government. Obviously, we have local partners. We have a good relationship with UNCW. So it's been a challenge, there's no doubt. We're still an organization that's well in our infancy, and we're still growing. But so far, so good. We think we've grown the service to meet the needs of the community without being a burden on the taxpayers. And we've been able to keep, especially in the latest economic times, to keep our costs and our subsidies from the city and county at an even level. So we're proud of what we've been able to provide with the limited resources we have.
And we are talking off air that ridership is increased to, I think you said 7-8%.
Absolutely. This past year we've seen ridership grow to the tune of about 7%, and that was through our fiscal year that ended June 30th of 2011. We're seeing ridership grow on all routes, and I think it's been a combination of things, not just the higher fuel prices, which are forcing some to be more transit dependent, but I think people are becoming comfortable with the services we're providing, the areas we're going. We had a full route restructuring in 2008, and certainly it was a big change from what we've been, or what the former Wilmington Transit Authority had been providing for the last 26 plus years. So it was a big change, but I think we've got the trust of the community. I think we've got the community on board to understand what we're trying to do with public transportation in the region.
It takes a long time to build that trust with the public.
Absolutely.
You know, speaking of ridership, one of the biggest myths within our community is that no one rides the buses. When folks see a bus ride by, they see very few people on there. Can you explain that whole process and the fact that the numbers are indeed up?
Sure. Public transportation ridership is very fluid. What you'll see if you ride a bus is you'll see throughout the route people getting on and off on a regular basis. So at any one time, the ridership on the bus may not seem like a lot, but there may be a handful of people, 10 or so. You know, one of the complaints we've got is, why don't you run smaller vehicles? Mm-hmm. Because it would actually maximize the use of the vehicle. And one of the challenges we have with that is that the smaller vehicles really aren't made to handle running 16 hours a day. We would see numerous breakdowns. We'd have to have a lot more spare vehicles. So it's really a trade-off between a vehicle that's built to run a heavy load for a long period of time versus a vehicle that's built to run on a short period of time.
Can you speak to some of the services that you all provide at CAFER Public Transportation Authority?
Sure, and I think one of the things that is to our advantage by being independent of the city and county government is that we can kind of reach out and do some things that really aren't traditional type of transit services. I talked a little bit earlier about working with Greyhound to provide service out of Fordham Station. That would maximize the use of the facility without adding relatively few costs to us. I mean, minimal for what we could bring in for acting as the broker for Greyhound. We also do human service transportation through contract with the Department of Social Services, and that's mostly non-emergency medical transportation, a lot of dialysis trips. We do over 400 trips a day on the human service side in our contract with not only New Hanover County Department of Social Services, but the Department of Aging and a lot of human service agencies throughout the region. We provide the Seahawk shuttle in and around UNCW campus. This allows the university to limit the amount of parking permits they get, but to allow students access to the campus through a shuttle type service that we offer. We also offer some park and rides to UNCW that allow students to park across the street, across College Road from campus, and have a safe way on the campus. We also provide, as I said, fixed route public transportation service, complimentary ADA paratransit service. We just launched a van pool where we have actually an employee of a company that drives several of his or her coworkers to work. We provide the vehicle. They pay a subsidy to Wave Transit to pay for the fuel, the insurance, the maintenance of the vehicle. So it's almost revenue neutral. It's a way to get a lot of cars off the road. The employers that we work with offer preferential parking. So we think that's a win-win, and we hope to kind of grow that program because we see that as kind of a new transit. It's more of a hybrid transit, if you will. We also have a big green initiative that we call Leading the Way. The Breathe Easy campaign highlights our two hybrid buses that we just recently put on the road. These are diesel electric hybrids that operate mostly on batteries, very low emissions, much better fuel economy.
Very quiet too, by the way.
Our new Fordham Station was built to meet LEED Gold standards, and we're working with the USGBC to get that LEED accreditation. Obviously, our van pool program is we consider to be one of our Breathe Easy and our green initiatives. So we think we provide a lot of different type of services than ones that someone would associate with traditional public transportation.
Okay. Well, we're going to take our first break here and continue the chairman's chat with Albert Eby, the executive director of Wave Transit. We'll be right back. Welcome back to our chat with the chairman. Joining us is Albert Eby, the executive director of the Cape Fear Transportation Authority, what we commonly called Wave Transit. It's the bus system that serves New Hanover County. You had mentioned earlier, Albert, the Greyhound proposal. Tell us more about that.
Yeah, we were excited when we started up the conversation with Greyhound. One of the things we've been working on here in New Hanover County, and this precedes me, it's been for the last 15 years, is a downtown multimodal transportation center. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of conversation has kicked up about it lately, especially since the state has invested a great deal of money into several properties along 3rd and 4th Street in downtown for the center. Greyhound, as you know, has a hub downtown where they provide six routes in and out of Wilmington every day. They approached us in our new Fordham station and asked if it would be a possibility for us to partner with them to provide service out of this station. It was more convenient to the interstate. It certainly made sense. It had a passenger waiting area, areas where we could deal with some of the packages that come in. And so we've started the conversation with Greyhound. We've actually sent them a draft contract, and hopefully by September you'll see Greyhound services rolling out of Fordham Station. The advantage to the community and to the Greyhound as well as Wave Transit passengers is it's going to provide them a seamless opportunity to get from an inner city bus to a local bus. And currently they would have to walk a long way to catch a downtown bus, typically with bags, sometimes with children. So we really feel that this is a huge advantage for the community without adding any additional costs.
Okay.
And just to talk about the $7 vehicle registration fee again, you know, I've fielded calls from folks that are in favor, but many that are not in favor. I got a call yesterday from an older young lady who indicated that, you know, I'm on a fixed income, you know, you all are taxing me out of this particular community. What is the benefit to the average citizen by raising the vehicle registration fee $7? What's going to be the benefit for the average citizen, but also for the community at large?
Public transportation financing in the United States is obviously a smorgasbord of a lot of different ways. In Greensboro, they do it by an ad valorem tax. In the Triangle, they do it by vehicle registration fees. They also do it by rental car fees. Here in New Hanover County, I think from a public transportation policy standpoint and financing public transportation, we've definitely been behind the eight ball for several years. We typically rely on the general funds that don't subsidize the other funds from Washington and Raleigh. Obviously, the advantage is a tough sell. Our goal, or my goal, as the executive director of Wave Transit, is to go out and to show the county commissioners who actually make the policy. I think it's important to understand that the authority, we don't make the policy. We let the duly elected officials make the policy, including vehicle registration fee. But we have to go out and gauge support, and that's what I'm doing right now. I'm going to meeting with the larger groups in the community. I meet with the school board, with the beach towns, with the chambers of commerce, and some of these other organizations to gauge the community support. If the community support is there, it's our responsibility to show the county commissioners the community wants this. This is something that would benefit the community. Certainly we see public transportation as an economic development tool. One of the things that a lot of folks may not know is that when Verizon was considered moving here several years ago, one of their company policies is that their facility has to be on a public transportation line. If it's not, they're not going to move there. Obviously, their location on Shipyard Boulevard at the time didn't have public transportation. We were able to spring into action, provide service there, so Verizon could come in and provide the economic generation they have. So in addition to being an economic generator, it also provides reduced traffic congestion. A lot of people say nobody rides the bus, but I think a good example that kind of illustrates that folks do ride the bus and that we do take cars off the road is we look at passengers per mile. Our average passengers per mile is about 1.1 passengers a mile. If you equate that to a person driving in their own car 10 miles to work, that would be 1/10 of a passenger per mile. So we're 11 times more efficient than someone that drives 10 miles alone in their car. Not only does that reduce our dependency on foreign oil, it also reduces emissions in the county. The county's been struggling very hard to keep our sulfur dioxide emission low and prevent us from becoming non-attainment. We think that Wave Transit can assist in the county becoming non-attainment by what we do for the environment.
Speaking of non-attainment, if we were to get that designation, that would be a benefit for you all, would it not?
I'd hate to say that it's a benefit, but it certainly opens opportunities for us to provide additional services through what they call CMAQ funds, or Congestion Mitigation Air Quality Funding. There's a great deal of funding that comes from the federal government to help try to clean up areas that are ozone non-attainment or sulfur dioxide non-attainment. So while it would be a blow to the county, certainly from an economic development standpoint, I think there's some things that we could do from the public transportation side to react to that. One of the things that we've been talking to Federal Transit and USDOT about is, let's look at these communities like New Hanover County that may be close to becoming non-attainment, that are growing rapidly, that are showing a lot of cars. Let's work before they become non-attainment to keep them non-attainment. Let's look at the possibility of having some CMAQ funds available to these communities before they get into that area, see if we can prevent the non-attainment from coming. So we certainly understand the problem. We think that we can provide a solution to assist in the problem, and certainly willing to work with the community and the county to make sure those things happen.
Yeah. I've been here over 20 years, and it's always seemed to me that our mass transit system's always been a little backwards. And not to be offensive or anything, Other cities seem to be doing much better with, you know, their bus service, light rail, maglev. There are all sorts of alternatives out there. Why has it been so difficult here?
I think the key word there is mass transit. What we're here in New Hanover County, where we have a very low population density, we don't have the opportunity to pack a lot of people on the bus. I think one thing a lot of people don't understand is that New York City, which is the largest transit system in the United States, receives more in federal and state subsidies than any other transit system in the United States. So there's not a transit system out there that operates free of any subsidy. They're very expensive to run. You talk about light rail. Charlotte just implemented a light rail line. Very difficult process to do, very expensive process. Their blue line, Link's blue line, cost almost $500 million. As much as they've been trying to get it done in the Triangle and the Triad, they still don't have the population density, they don't have the congestion issues, they don't have the air quality issues that rise to the standard to meet that type of investment from the federal government. So what we like to refer to ourselves here is as public transportation. And the truth is many of our riders are what we would consider transit dependent. They don't have any other way to get around. The advantage of what we do is that anybody can get on the bus. You don't have to be transit dependent. You don't have to be of a certain socioeconomic class. You don't have to be of a certain race or a certain gender. Anybody can get on our vehicles and utilize it at any time. So our goal is to make it as attractive and as convenient as possible for anyone in the community so it makes sense to use it.
Okay. You talked earlier about the intermodal center that's been talked about for years and years for downtown Wilmington. What's your role there?
At this point, the environmental document is being prepared. Now that the state owns the property down there, they plan to, at least at this point, go in two phases. The first phase would be the transit portion of it, which would be Wave Transit, Greyhound, taxis, our downtown trolley that I failed to mention a little bit earlier, would all utilize the service. The second phase would be intercity rail between here and Raleigh. The environmental document is being wrapped up. Once that is done, the Federal Transit Administration will be asked to be the lead agency for this. Once they are, as designated recipient, Wave Transit would take the lead in this construction of this facility, which would utilize two currently existing buildings, one the old Newworth building at the corner of 3rd and Campbell Street, the other the old Stein Furniture building at 4th and Campbell. So our goal is to make sure that those facilities are constructed to meet the needs of downtown, a growing downtown, a progressive downtown. And they wouldn't just be transit facilities. There could be an opportunity for public-private partnership to do retail space, to do office space, to do residential space. So we're certainly going to look at all the options before we decide to build this facility and how we move forward into making sure it fits the needs of downtown.
you talked about bringing rail back to Wilmington, from Wilmington to Raleigh. There's no track.
That's the biggest challenge faced right now by NCDOT Rail Division. There would be significant track upgrades, not just to add track, but to straighten out track so that the train could go at a speed that can compete with cars. Just like public transportation on the bus side, the rail side is fighting the automobile, and it's oftentimes a losing battle. But we've got to get our transportation infrastructure back to a point where we can at least be ready to go away from the automobile if things like fossil fuels, become more and more scarce and hard to get. As we look to things like electric cars, where you're getting less and less miles to the gallon, less and less distance before you have to find a way to refuel. So we've got to be ready with the transportation infrastructure that's going to meet the needs of the community 50 years from now.
Okay, and you recently you mentioned the Fordham station. You recently opened that up over there by the Target store.
Yes, sir, and it serves as our, we've got several hubs within Wilmington. A lot of communities are laid out where they go from a center downtown on what we would consider a hub and spoke. Wilmington's a little different with the river on one side and the beach on the other. So we use multiple of transfer locations. We use Independence Mall, we use downtown and our new Fordham station, but it also serves as our administrative facility for our board meetings where the public can come in and interact with the board. They can interact with me and the senior staff of Wave Transit. It also offers indoor waiting areas, automatic vehicle location times, real bus information time as to where the buses are. So we're really proud of it. Fortunately named after a pioneer in our community who chaired the former Wilmington Transit Authority, Harry Fordham. was good to have his family down here, and I think it really speaks well for the community that we were able to get something like this done.
I remember him well. We need to take a little break here, but when we continue our chat with the chairman, we'll be talking more with Albert Eby, the executive director of Wave Transit, so stay with us. Welcome back to our chat with the chairman. With us is Albert Eby, the executive director of Wave Transit. We had originally, and a lot of things have come up in this last 20 minutes or so, but we originally asked you to come on to talk about the $7 registration fee that would be charged on every vehicle registered in New Hanover County. Tell us what that process is.
Like I said earlier, we've started the process way back in 2007 to see if there was community support for additional public transportation services here in New Hanover County and Northern Brunswick. We operate under the Metropolitan Planning Organization's boundary, so we also serve a portion of Northern Brunswick and of Southern Pender County, so it's not just New Hanover County. But I think, you know, the fee is just one tool that we can use to provide these additional public transportation services if the community supports it. And I got to reiterate that this is really about what the community wants, not what Wave Transit wants. We're not here to impose our will on anybody. We're here to meet the needs of the community and provide the public transportation services that are in line with what the community wants. We've developed a plan. It's on our website at wavetransit.com. If you go to the homepage, it talks about the plan and it gets into great detail about the specifics of the plan and also how much revenue it would raise. It's projected to raise in December, based on the number of cars registered in New Hanover County, it would raise about $1.1 million. Not only would that help us provide this type of service to the beach, but it also helps us get access to other funds. Most of federal transit and state transit dollars are matching funds. Mm-hmm. So the more local funds we can put toward it, the more economies of scale, and we can really maximize this federal or the local investment in transit with state and federal money.
So why not just raise the rate, the bus fare?
That's an interesting argument, and a lot of people have asked me that since I've been making this presentation. And unfortunately, the higher you raise the fare, the more passengers you lose. It'd be great to say that we could raise the fare and we could continue to get passengers, but that's not the reality. Not here in Wilmington and New Hanover County, but not in the United States. You get into what's called fare elasticity. The higher you raise your rates, the more passengers you lose. And at some point, it becomes less of an opportunity for folks that are transit dependent, like I talked about earlier, to have access to jobs, to have access to medical trips, to have access to transportation. So, you know, one of the good things about transit is it keeps people from relying on government services for their subsistence, for, you know, DSS, for food stamps, or the opportunity not to go to work. This does allow them the opportunity to work, to go to medical trips, to get educational opportunities, to get their kids out in the community. So really, it is going to depend on what the community wants.
You know, Albert, I recently mentioned that we as a community have got to define who we are and what we want in terms of public transportation. I just returned back from our National Association of Counties annual conference in Portland, Oregon, and there, their mass transit, and the key word is mass, which means more than one line of transit to get back and forth. They had light rail, which I took light rail every day to our convention center, walked out of my hotel right to the end of the block, got on there, and I guess they had a free zone between one area, which for me, the hotel and the convention center was within that free zone. But the county commissioners there and their transit system actually gave every commissioner that came in their town a free pass to ride the light rail throughout the whole entire community, just to give us a taste and a feel for what they provide there. But not only that, they had Amtrak running through the city, as well as other trains running through, but also buses as well, and realizing that apparently Portland itself is roughly 600,000 citizens, but then you have the surrounding suburbs around there that gives you well over a million people. And how do you move that many people back and forth? And the one thing that I noticed there was even during rush hour on the freeway, the interstate, you still had, you know, traffic backed up as well. And we've got to decide and define, you know, what it is that we want here in terms of mass transit, how we want to get people around, not just for today, but, you know, 15, 20 years down the road as our population here in New Hanover County increases. I think we had an increase of roughly 40,000 plus people between the last census and the one we just conducted back in 2010, which means that this is a very popular place. It's the second smallest county in the state, but also one of the most densely populated. And just some observations that I noticed there. But one point I want to ask you about is many people talk about the response time for buses to make their loop. And I know we've talked about a thing called BRT, Bus Rapid Transit, to where we have a dedicated line in a certain part of our community. Can you speak to that and explain to the citizens what that is all about?
Sure. Bus Rapid Transit takes the advantage of having a rubber-tired vehicle like a bus, but put it on a dedicated right-of-way like you would see with rail. One thing, as Bus Rapid Transit has evolved over the last 10 years, that communities have found is that oftentimes developers don't see the full commitment from the government to have a line that they can develop around, because a bus rapid transit line can be moved. So it is a great challenge. It does require a high population density, but it is in our long-range plan. I think getting back to the thing you talked about, Portland, I think that's important. A lot of the feedback that I've gotten as this $7 fee is kind of floated out there is, I would like to ride the bus if it was more convenient, if I didn't have to walk several blocks to get it, if it operated on a more convenient service. But obviously it's a chicken egg thing, because to do that you have to put more money into the system. So Portland was very smart, and this is where I think transit in the future, and you talked about where we wanted to be in the future, is kind of out of our hands, because it really falls into the field of land use planning. Unfortunately, in New Hanover County and City of Wilmington, we've got a strong planning departments, but they've got to understand that this rapid sprawl and keeping people farther and farther out really makes transit less and less attractive. The good thing about Portland is that they restrict development outside a certain area, and you can't go outside of a certain zone. So they keep their population densities tight. They make sure that their housing and that their economic development, as well as the businesses that develop, know that there's a lot of people there that can access their business. So it's successful for the community, successful for the businesses, successful for public transportation, and for a lot of other things. So, you know, hopefully we can get our message out there that land use planning, transportation planning is really going to play a very pivotal role as we move forward.
Now, with your board of directors for Wave Transit, how often do you meet? Where do you meet? How can the average citizen come in and weigh in on some of the discussions that are there?
Sure. We meet every month, the fourth Thursday of every month, at Fordham Station, which is located behind Costco at 505 Candu Street. I mentioned earlier transparency. If you go to our website, wavetransit.com, we've got our minutes out there, we've got our agendas out there, we've got a lot of documents out there that talk about how we do, what we do, how we do it, why we do it, where we get our funding from. There's a very detailed document that explains our budget that we just passed recently. We also have a public comment session at every board meeting, at the first every board meeting. You don't have to sign up, you don't have to call in advance. You can come in, you can ride a bus, you can come in, you can give your feedback to the board and let us know, the authority know what your thoughts are, and that's how we gauge the support of the community. So we would encourage anybody that's interested either in the vehicle registration fee, service to the beaches, or Wave Transit in general, please come and let us know. And our next meeting will be August 25th. That's a Thursday. It'll be at noon at Fordham Station.
Okay. You talked about some citizen involvement. Of course, they could always apply to be a member of the authority as well.
Absolutely. The county commissioners appoint 5 members. The City of Wilmington Council appoints the other 5 members, and there's one joint appointee, which is a human service agency representative.
Okay.
With 13 members on that board?
11 members.
11
yes,
members
sir.
On that board.
Yes, sir.
And I think they all bring a certain level of expertise to the board as well to help us make good informed decisions, right down to the building of Fordham Station and the future planning for routes as well. And we're always getting input from citizens on whether this route works for them or whether it doesn't work for them.
And I can tell you, the one thing I've been most encouraged about in the 7 years as serving as the executive director of the authority is that we've had several meetings. We meet every month. Not one meeting we failed to have a quorum, and that means we've got dedicated people that are being appointed by the city and county. We've got dedicated elected officials like yourself that serve on the authority, that understand the importance of what we're doing and to make sure that the business continues to get done. So we're very fortunate that we've got the leadership from the board with Wave Transit, and hopefully we can get some more community input.
Now, you did mention with the $7 fee, or not the fee, but the fact that Wave Transit serves the northern part of Brunswick County as well as Pender County. Now, for the citizens in another county with a $7 vehicle registration fee, is that going to benefit the other counties as well?
Not the way the plan is written. Currently, we don't have any service, although Southern Pender County is in our service area. We don't provide any service. And the service to Brunswick County, Northern Brunswick County, through Leland, Belleville, and Navassa, that's supported by federal transit subsidies, through state transit subsidies, as well as Brunswick County and those 3 municipalities. So it would not reduce the cost of any of those programs, the vehicle registration fee. It would just be focused on the needs of New Hanover County.
And final question, when do you expect to take your registration proposal to the Board of Commissioners? Who has final say?
We're still gauging community support. Okay. Once we have determined if the community supports there, then we will bring it to the commissioners probably sometime in the fall.
Okay. Anything else?
I'm good.
Okay. Well, we are about out of time for this edition of our chat with the chairman. Chairman Jonathan Barfield Jr. will be here every 2 weeks for a new program. Looking ahead, we've got a county commissioner meeting. Well, actually, we just had one last night. So the 15th, I think, would be the next commissioner meeting.
Somewhere along those lines, we'll also have a work session dealing with economic development prior to that meeting as well. Don't forget, you can follow New Orleans County on Twitter and find us on Facebook. And if you have a specific question regarding New Orleans County government, send us an email. If we use your question on the show, you'll receive an Underneath It All t-shirt. Send your questions to NHCTV and at nhcgov.com. I'm New Orleans County Board of Commissioners Chairman Jonathan Barfield, Jr.
And I'm Mark Boyer. Thanks for joining us.